Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship at Good Shepherd. Welcome to those who worship here, those who watch it on live stream or on a broadcast in the days to come. A few announcements. First of all, today following worship, we'll have coffee fellowship downstairs, and then a few minutes after coffee fellowship starts, I'm going to lead a brief Bible study, and I often just go up to a table near the stage and invite people to come forward. Going to be a brief Bible study, kind of an unusual topic, talking about those whom Jesus had in his flock, those who traveled with him everywhere, and then what the Bible says about how he funded this ministry of his for those 3 years when he traveled around. And so you're welcome to come to that and either just sit and listen or participate, either way. So that's after worship today. Tomorrow the church council meets on Wednesday at 11 a.m. Senior Saints meets Wednesday, 11 a.m. at Broadway Apartments. Everyone 55 and above are welcome to that, and a free meal is served. Wednesday supper that evening is served from 5 to 6, and this week the menu is chicken kiev and chicken cordon bleu. Next week, next Sunday, the church office will have your annual reports ready for you to review, and then I believe it's next Sunday, right? Next Sunday, and then the Wednesday following that, there'll be a review of the budget that will take place after worship, both then Sunday and Wednesday the 24th, give you a chance to discuss it in advance to the meeting. And the Good Shepherd annual meeting is a week later than it often is. Usually we've had it at the end of January. This year we're having it the first Sunday in February, February 3rd. And that'll be at 10 a.m. or shortly after worship here in the sanctuary. Sunday, February 3rd is the annual meeting. And then lastly, kind of a plea, I am so grateful that we have that we continue to have education on Sunday mornings, that we offer Sunday school. Right now we have three faithful volunteers who see to it that we have teacher for Sunday morning. As you know, the kids leave after the children's sermon, and then they come back shortly before worship is done. And so a little more than half hour or so is what the length of the time is. Right now, of our three faithful volunteers, two are expecting babies within about a week of each other. So what I am asking of you is to consider teaching Sunday school. Even just one time would help out a lot. Because then I just don't want it to fall solely on this one person. And what we do is we provide curriculum, and we can even provide it well in advance to the time you teach. And we have materials in the classroom, lesson plan and stuff for the kids. So if you could consider that, I'd really appreciate it. And let me know if you would consider doing that even once. I'd appreciate it, because I really am hoping that we can continue without a break having Sunday school on Sunday mornings. Those are all the announcements that I have. The rest are there printed in your bulletins. And we're going to sing our opening hymns today, Out of Your Gray, Praise and Worship. We're just going to follow Gene's lead in terms of how many times through each of these songs will be done, two times each. So if you want to rise and get out your gray, praise and worship, and we're going to start with 168.
Thank you.
then with 236 in the same gray hymnal. Join me for the order of confession and forgiveness, and it's printed on the cover of your bulletin. We gather this morning for worship in the name of the Father and the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. For the well-being of all God's children, we confess our sins before God and one another. Faithful teacher, as we become fully immersed in a new year, we ask for your forgiveness for those things we have done that bring harm to you, others, or ourselves. Cleanse us from our sin and transform us by your forgiveness. Our Lord Jesus walked on this earth to bring forgiveness and new life to all. In Jesus' name, I proclaim to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. Today we are made new by the abundant love of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then I invite you to sing together the Kyrie, and this time you're going to have to reach and get your red hymnal, and it's in the front, not the hymn numbers, but the page numbers, page 184. Please join me now as we pray together. The prayer of the day is printed on the cover of your bulletin. Righteous God, you sent your son Jesus to be baptized by John in the Jordan so that all might hear the proclamation of your love. Make us voices of proclamation so that all might know of your love through our words and our actions. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. At this time, I invite you to be seated, and I invite kids to come up for a children's message. Good morning. Hi, Deacon. Here comes Tyson. Good morning. I brought something with me today. See if you can recognize what this is. Valentine's. Yep, Valentine's. Yeah, it's specifically, it's Paw Patrol. And it comes with 32 Valentine's and even some for the teacher. But now, I'm not a student anymore. I don't go to school. So who would I give these to then instead of giving them to my classmates? Who could I give them? Oh, my loved ones, right? Because that's why we do Valentine's, isn't it? What message do we give with a Valentine? You give it to your mom and dad. Why do you give it to your mom and dad? What do you want to say to them with a Valentine? That you love them, right? So I could find 32 people, right? And it doesn't have to be my classmates, right? I could find 32 people. And what would I say with this message if I give them a card? That I love them, right? Now, ooh, look at this one. This one's nice, Paw Patrol. Look at this one. Now, who might you give this one to? Ooh. Or who else? Your brother? Tyson says you might give it to your brother, right? Who would you give this to if you had it? Mom. Your mom and dad, right? And again, you'd want to say with a heart, what are you saying to them? I love you, right? Now what, is this the only way we have to say I love you? No? How else? We can show by our actions. What kind of actions would say I love you? What kind of actions would say I love you? Because we don't only say it at Valentine's Day with a Paw Patrol Valentine, right? So how else can we let people know we love them? A hug? A hug? Right? That's an action that shows we love them. What else can we do to share our love? We don't only have to give a Paw Patrol Valentine, right? What else? Ooh, a kiss. What else can we do to let people know we love them? We can hug them. We can kiss them. We can give them a Paw Patrol Valentine. Anything else we can...
Appreciate them.
Appreciate them, right? Yep, and that's by saying thank you. That's the best way, right? Thank you for all that they do. You stayed over at Grandpa and Grandma's house right last night, right? So what could you say to them?
I think so.
What could you say to them to show your appreciation for all they do? You could say thanks, right? Is there any other way that we can let people know that we love them? What else can we do? Hug, yep, hug and kiss. Can we use our words? What kind of words would you use? A Valentine's, and what else? What? Thanking them, any other words, what? I love you, right? And it's easy to do, isn't it? Watch this. Trudy, you do so many wonderful things to help so many people. I love you.
I love you too, Mary.
That wasn't too hard, was it? No, and I've gotten to know Trudy, and I appreciate so many of the things she does. She's so kind and helps people. And that's one way we can do it. Not only saying thank you and appreciating, But just saying those words right out to her, okay? So there's many wonderful things. We can share, we can smile, is another word. Share kindness. It is, it really is one of the best ones. Today, in our Bible story that we're going to read here in worship, it tells the story of the day that Jesus came to be baptized. Now, he didn't come here to the bowl. He went to a river. And my favorite part of the story is this. At the very end of the baptism, he came up out of the water, and a voice came from heaven. Who do you think that might have been? God was talking to Jesus and said, "This is my son. This is my child. Oh, and I love my child." That was one of my favorite parts of the story. And the wonderful thing that happens is when you are baptized, Deacon, or when you are baptized, okay, especially I remember it with you, because I was there that day, I got to say those words. I got to say, "Deacon, you have a new name now, and it's Child of God, and God loves you." Okay, so I got to say those words. That at Jesus' baptism, it was God that said those words. And it's the same message that comes to you. You are God's child. Even you, and you, and you, and you, and you, okay? I remember saying that years too, okay? And that God says, "You're my child, and I love you." And it is the best part of baptism, that you receive a second name. And what's your second name? God's child. Right, children of God. And who loves you always? God does. Yep. He's with us all the time. And that's a wonderful promise that comes to us. And we don't have to wait for a Valentine to get it, but we can hear it all the time, that we are a child of God. Who's a child of God? We are. Right? Yep. Yep, and so we're all God's children, and who loves us? Always. God does, right? So we don't even have to wait for Valentine's. Let's say a prayer. Okay, ready? Take your hands, put them together. We're going to say thank you to God. Dear God, thank you for naming us. Thank you for naming us beloved children of God. Beloved children of God. Help us remember. Help us remember. You always love us. You always love us. Help us share that love. Help us share that love. Amen. Amen. Thanks for coming up. Sunday school teacher is going to meet you at the door over here. I think you know your Sunday school teacher today, Bexley. Yep, it's Mama. Go to Mama. Or are you going to Daddy?
Thank you. The psalm this morning is from Psalm 147, verses 1 through 12, read responsively. Praise the Lord! How good it is to sing praises to our God, for he is gracious, and a song of praise is fitting.
The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcasts of Israel.
He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds.
He determines the number of the stars. He gives to all of them their names.
Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure.
The Lord lifts up the downtrodden. He casts the wicked to the ground.
Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God on the lyre.
He covers the heavens with clouds, prepares rain for the earth, makes grass grow on the hills.
He gives to the animals their food, and to the young ravens when they cry.
His delight is not in the strength of the horse, nor his pleasure in the speed of the runner.
But the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, in those who hope in his steadfast love.
Praise the Lord, O Jerusalem. Praise your God, O Zion.
Here ends the psalm reading.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the third chapter. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the voice of one whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Israel and all of Judea were going out to him and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, John said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these very stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now, the axe is lying at the root of the tree. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down, thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance. One who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire, and his winnowing fork is in his hand. He will clear the threshing floor. He will gather the wheat into the granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." Then Jesus came from Galilee to John by the Jordan to be baptized by him. Now John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, saying, "Let it be so, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness." So John consented. And when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens opened to him. He saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." Word of God. Word of life. Grace to you and peace from God the Father, from our Lord and our Savior, who is Jesus the Christ. I was hardly the perfect child when I was growing up. I put more than a few gray hairs on the head of my parents, Keith and Sharon. I challenged them for independence when I was a teenager, and every time that I did that, without fail, it seemed that my dad would then sit me down and lecture. That was his style. Every time I disobeyed, every time I frustrated them, What would come would be a lecture from my dad. He would sit me down and he would talk and try to talk wisdom to me, try to change my ways. He would talk and talk. I grew very accustomed to that routine by the time I moved away from their home, moved away from Austin, and moved to college. Those lectures were routine until one day. I knew that what I did was wrong by inviting friends over to our home without asking permission. I knew my parents would be gone, and they said they would be home around midnight, and so I figured that if I had my friends leave by 11, I would have time to clean up, and they would never know what happened in their home. Well, that might have been the case if they kept to what they had committed to and come home at midnight, like they said. Instead, they came home around 10 p.m., and my friends were still there. We had not cleaned up. And so when they came home, I hustled my friends out the door so they would not have to witness my dad lecturing to me. They left. My dad was silent. And I hustled around the house and I cleaned up. My dad was silent. And I got done cleaning up, and before bed then, I stood there and I waited for him to invite me to the Davenport for that customary lecture. And there was silence. No lecture. No words of advice. No wisdom from one who walked uphill to school both ways. Nothing but silence. And finally, I went to bed. And then the next day, more silence. And the day after that, and by that time I had figured out quite clearly just how disappointed my dad was in me. And finally, after quite a few days of silence, he finally invited me to sit down on the couch. And instead of lecturing me, there was more silence. He simply asked me, "Explain yourself." And I had to do the talking that time. And I ended up apologizing. And in the end, my dad hugged me and forgave me and told me he loved me. But it was dramatic to deal with silence from someone whom I was so used to hearing so much from. Silence was unnerving. And truth be told, I think a lot of us, the same could be said for us. We don't always do well with silence. Even though many of us beg for peace and quiet because of all the noise we hear in our lives, what do we do when we walk into our silent homes, so many of us? What do we turn on? Yep, the radio, the TV. Many of us do that because even though we say we want peace and say we want quiet, when we're in our homes and they're completely silent, many of us are unnerved by it. We need the voices of people around us speaking, whether it be voices of wisdom and encouragement or voices that speak hard truths that are painful but necessary to hear. As I learned then as a teenager, sometimes even harsh voices are better than no voice at all. With that story, I want us to think about the center of our story today, at least part of our story, who is John the Baptist. As we open the Gospel of Matthew, and we're going to be reading through Matthew in these months to come, we've reached now the third chapter of Matthew. And one of the first stories that Matthew introduces us to, one of the people he introduces us to and as he opens his Gospel, is John. 2,000 years ago, John the Baptist was the prophet whom God sent to the people to announce Jesus, the Messiah, is coming to lead you, to teach you, to change your lives, to give you life eternal. Too often we make a big ordeal about what an oddball John was, that he was a wilderness hermit, that he wore camel's hair, that he ate grasshoppers for lunch. But what he looked like and what he ate is not nearly as important as the message that John preached. And it's not even as important as the fact that John brought a message. Because, you see, for hundreds and hundreds of nearly 1,000 years, God spoke to the people through the prophets. Oh, and the people were used to it, that there was somebody that led them and was the voice of God. And these prophets were real people in their midst. There were Jeremiah and Joel and Isaiah and Micah and Ezekiel and Amos and many others. And they knew them as the voice of God, God's mouthpiece, to give them direction and encouragement, sometimes harsh words or criticism or leading them to a right path. And this is how God spoke for thousands of years, through the voice of the prophets. But then, one day, the voice of God fell silent. After the prophet Malachi died, no more prophets were used by God. And there was silence. For 400 years, the voice of God did not speak. There was no encouragement from God, no advice, no guidance from God, nothing. Silence. Which, I can tell you, can be tough. Especially if you're used to hearing words. So 400 years, generation after generation, the people had silence from God. And they had stories from their ancestors about all the times that God spoke, and they knew these words that God had spoken to them. They'd been written down by that time. They had silence. And then suddenly, a new voice suddenly appeared. And it was a crusty character named John who turned up in the wilderness along the banks of the River Jordan, and John spoke and he preached a message of repentance, which means change or turning around. And it was a bold message, and he even said odd things like, "You are a bunch of vipers." You know what a viper is? Snake. "You are a bunch of snakes. Repent. Change your lives." John the Baptist, with his bold style of preaching, was the one whom God used then, after a long silence. Now, John would probably not have impressed many call committees in modern-day churches, but know this, the people of God responded when they heard John preaching. The people came out of the cities to him, to the wilderness, to hear his message and to be baptized by him. They were overjoyed because finally there was no more silence. And the people trusted that John's voice was coming from God, proclaiming a truth to them about what to believe, how to live. And they listened, gladly listened. And John the Baptist, in his message, pointed beyond himself to Jesus and announced to them, "While you may be impressed with me," he said, "someone's coming. His name is Jesus, and he's going to baptize, and he is going to live in a relationship with us." And as if on cue, at least the way that Matthew writes it, then he came. Jesus appeared, and he asked John, "Baptize me." And as the water flowed over his head, Jesus was filled with the Holy Spirit, and the heavens opened up, and a voice called out and announced to Jesus, "You're my child, you're my son, you're my beloved, I am so well pleased with you." And that's how Jesus began his ministry, with the baptism from John, with approval from God, with an affirmation, "You are my beloved child." Story. The first really bad school shooting to rattle our country took place in Columbine, right? We all know what Columbine means when we say that name. Outside of Denver, Colorado, the year 1999. and a pastor who served at a Lutheran church near Littleton, Colorado, where Columbine was. Soon after the shooting, started noticing a man coming to worship regularly, someone he had never seen before. And the man was about 30 years old, and he noticed that he would come into worship just after the opening hymn had started, so he couldn't greet him before worship. He would sit in the back, he would participate, and then during the closing song, out the door went the man. Week after week, month after month, and the pastor couldn't get the opportunity to speak with him. Some weeks in, the pastor noticed that this man visiting at worship came dressed in a firefighter shirt. So at least he figured out something more about the man. And finally, one week, the pastor went to the back of the church to start the opening hymn to catch that young man before he left worship. And he got to meet him officially. He found out that the young man's name was Matt. And he did, as he'd figured out, work at a nearby fire station. And Matt explained that aside from a random funeral or wedding, he had never been to church, to Sunday worship in his life. But he had questions. In fact, he said to the pastor, "Today's story that you preached on was the one we read today, the Bible story about the baptism of Jesus." And Matt said, "What is baptism? What does it mean?" And they discussed it. And then Matt ended up laughing and saying, "Well, I feel like I'm baptized most every time we turn on the fire hose, because I'm drenched with the water, fighting a fire." Eventually, Matt ended up sharing that he was a first responder the day that the shooting at Columbine took place. Matt explained that Matt told the pastor what he had seen, how he had been one who had been assigned to go into the school library after the investigation had been completed, and he had been assigned to take the bodies of the victims out of the school. And he said that whole experience changed me. He said it changed everybody who worked there that day. And he said, "This experience made me think, what is life about? Am I living the life that I want to live? What are my priorities?" Because he said, "I realized as I saw those students and the life that they weren't living anymore," he said, "I realized life could change suddenly." Matt ended up being baptized in worship a few weeks later. And he did so, he said, because he wanted to live a deeper life, a life with purpose. And he said, "I want to have that identity. I want to be named as a beloved child of God. And I want to carry with me that knowledge that I am loved by God, that I have a living relationship with God." And for him, it was a new beginning. So we read about John baptizing, and we read about Jesus being baptized, and we hear about Matt being baptized, and then there's another baptism, and it's yours. And some people think that being baptized is like joining the Jesus Club. Others think of baptism as like they would be buying hell insurance, meaning that they're ensuring that once the waters of baptism have bathed them, they won't burn in hell. And I prefer to think of baptism more like an adoption into the family of God. Just as the Spirit came upon Jesus at baptism and proclaimed him a child of God, in our baptism, we are adopted by God, and the Spirit of God fills us, and our relationship with God is transformed that day in baptism. God also looks at us, just as he did with Jesus, and declares us beloved children of God, with whom God is well pleased, with whom God's soul delights. God does not treat our baptism as a one-time event. But to God, it's an eternal claim over our lives. We are sealed as beloved, as beloved children of a living God. And each and every day, really, we walk in that baptism, and God never lets us go and holds us close every day. And the best part is, God is not silent, but reminds us again and again and again that we are God's beloved. Even if he's using me to say it to you this day or to say to the kids, reminding us again and again, you're God's beloved. You're a child of God. God will never let you go. God delights in you. And you hear it again and again and again throughout your days, throughout your weeks. And hear it here and hear it now. You're a child of God, and God is so well pleased and loves you so much. Share that love. Share that good news so it's not silent again. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we give you thanks for the gift of grace that comes to us in the water and the word. Strengthen us with your power. Let us hear from you, God, forever and always, that in your baptism we are your beloved. And with us you are well pleased. May we follow you faithfully as we live in a relationship with you. Thanks be to God. Amen. We're going to sing about baptism now. The words to this hymn are on the back of your bulletin. It's entitled Down by the Jordan. I invite you to rise, and you may turn in your red hymnal to page 105 at the front of the hymnal as we join together in proclaiming our common faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please greet one another with this peace which comes from God.
This week, Pastor Mary will visit both Broadway Apartments and Shepherd's Inn to lead a short worship service and serve Holy Communion to the residents there. Your generous offering dollars helps us bring regular care to our members who live in both of those facilities, as well as Parkview Care Center. Thank you for your offering dollars, which helps us share God's love near and far. Please rise now as we sing together hymn number 800, Spirit of God.
Thank you.
the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, let us now pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Gracious Lord God, we give you thanks after a long silence you spoke through John the Baptist. We look to you, God, for direction, for encouragement, for assistance. We know that John pointed to Jesus, your beloved Son, God, with whom you were well pleased. And we give you thanks that you speak these same words to us, that we are named by you as a beloved child of God and that we are your beloved. Help us listen, help us hear. Help us always remember that nothing can separate us from your love. Lord, in your mercy, we give you thanks, God, for the safe return home of Jamie Kloss. Bring her healing as she adjusts following her long ordeal. We lift up in prayer all other families who are searching for lost loved ones. Lord, in your mercy, we long for your words of forgiveness and the touch of your healing hand, Lord. Today we lift up in prayer all those who struggle, all those who suffer. We pray for those who are going without paychecks in the midst of the government shutdown. We pray for all who struggle to buy groceries or pay for housing. We lift up those who are in need of strength and healing. Today we pray for Nancy Kidd, Carolyn Willette, Patricia Johnson Schumacher, Sue V, Bebo Getchell, and all others whom we name now silently in our hearts. Shower them with strength and with healing. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, John the Baptist prepared the way for his people to receive Jesus Christ. We pray, God, that you would light within us the fire of God's love, that your light may shine through us to bring your love to our world. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. May the Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever. Amen. Our sending song is hymn number 732.
Thank you.
fellowship is being served.
Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.